pomp and ceremony from the golden days of Great Britain. Or were they golden? That's what we'll be talking about this afternoon. Just how good were the good old days? It might surprise you to know that there are over 1.5 million people living in Britain today who were born during the reign of Queen Victoria, and therefore could be called Victorians. Meet four of them with us now. Fenner Brockway, Labour politician, journalist, author, and ex-convict in the best of all possible ways. Now he's 91. V.S. Pritchett, writer, critic, lecturer, man of letters. He will be 80 this year. Juliette Huxley, widow of the biologist Julian Huxley, and a traveller and writer herself. Doesn't it strike you that what dates a picture is the transport in it? And I'm wondering, Fenner, what is the kind of transport that you are particularly nostalgic about?
Transport? Not very much. In the earliest days, very little public transport. But I haven't a very strong memory of that. I am nostalgic, not so much about transport. I think the thing that I'm nostalgic about is the comradeship and the fellowship which used to be in the socialist movement in the early days. We never stayed in hotels, but the spirit of enthusiasm and devotion which was in ordinary men and women is something which I miss today.
Mm-hmm. Juliette, coming to transport, however, again.
Yes.
Are you nostalgic about something?
Well, in my young days, cars hadn't been invented. Bicycles had three wheels, and of course, I'd never rode one. I liked walking. I mean, we walked a lot. We walked to school every day, 1.5 miles, getting up to get to school at 8 o'clock in the morning without turning a hair. Mm. Walking was what one did.
Mm-hmm. Barbara, what about you?
Well, mine doesn't go back very far because it's still in the days of aeroplanes, but I sigh for the days of comfortable aeroplanes, and particularly for one that I think was called the Constellation, in which you could cross the Atlantic and you took your seat and then you went, if you wanted, downstairs to the bar and you had a drink. And then, believe it or not, you went upstairs and undressed and went to bed. And I remember thinking in my little nylon nightie, how terribly chilly it will be if this thing goes down in mid-Atlantic.
Do you mean, sorry for my ignorance about an aeroplane, but was it a double-decker? You didn't go upstairs.
You did go. No, you
really?
Went. No, the saloon had these berths, you see, which were tucked away like a modern sleeper or a Trans-American. They don't have many trains now. train, like a Pullman train. And then I crossed the Pacific in it, and I thought, well, it might be worse here because if it goes down, the little nylon nightie will be all right, but there'll be the sharks.
Victor, what about you? Have you got a particular nostalgia?
Well, this is purely boasting, but I remember that I was taken on a tram, a horse tram, from London Bridge to Tower Bridge by my father, and stood in this horrible vehicle, which made an awful clanking noise, just beside the driver and his pony, which trotted all the way. But in fact, my real nostalgia is for trains, simply because they gave me, always a reading man, such an enormous amount of time to read. I've done so much reading in trains that it's something I really miss.
Don't you think that when you're on a train you can't be got at, therefore it gives you, a writer, a great privacy?
Well, it works both ways. Sometimes if I'm on a train, people are so interesting in their chat in the train that I stop being, I just listen like this. But otherwise, if I don't really like the sound of their voices, I get my book like this and start reading.
I can't imagine you've ever driven a car, Fenner.
Never.
Is that right?
Yes.
Yes? So what did you used to use? Bikes?
No. I was at a boarding school, and at a boarding school, one very rarely went out at all. I was just put on a train to my grandfather's under the care of the guard. Mm. But I remember little about transport. I remember the old buses sitting on the front of the tops of buses, horse-driven. Mm. With no cover, but otherwise I didn't travel much. Mm.
You travelled, Juliet, very early on.
Yes, very early on.
Easier do you think it was then than now?
Well, it was much slower, of course.
Yes.
Now we have the age of speed. In fact, I heard this morning on television, on the radio, that a man has gone right round the world in 44 hours. Now, Jules Verne took 80 days, didn't he? Well, there's quite a change there, isn't it? In fact, I think that is a little distressing, this kind of hunger for speed, speed, speed.
Was it unusual for you, a woman, to have gone as early as you did on your own?
I don't know. I didn't feel it so. Mm. I accompanied my grandmother to England from Switzerland when I was 16 and came back alone. She, for some reason, had to have somebody to be with her because she'd been ill. I don't know what I could have done to help her, but anyway, I was sent along with her. And I came back. I didn't have any trouble at all. In those days, it took 24 hours from London to my hometown, Neuchâtel.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes, I've travelled a lot in the course of my life. I think I've been in prison in five continents, but not in the sense that Fenner was. I went in on my own accord and came out of my own accord.
You mean a visitor?
Yes, a visitor.
I think you were quite young when you went on a canoe.
Oh,
I've just been reading your autobiography.
Yes, as students, we used to do, friend of mine who's still living and living quite near me, we used to do canoeing trips together. And there was one very unfortunate occasion outside Stratford-on-Avon, of all places, where we had a terribly wet day, and we generally slept in the canoe, but it was evening and it was terribly wet, and we drew up under a tree, and finally we gave in and we said we'll go into a hotel. It was in Stratford, and it was full of American tourists, very smart and all that, and in we went. And we were not accustomed to drinking, but we thought we would have some wine. And it was the first time in my life, I think, that I ever made the mistake of drinking rather more wine than I should have done. And she was in the same case. And we were outrageously clothed and very ashamed. And I can't tell you the end of the story. We went out into the streets and walked about a bit until we came to. I don't think we were really very drunk. But
why can't you tell me the end of the story?
Well, because I don't remember it.
Oh, I see. Right, well, that's a good answer.
I thought it was rather wicked when I was about 20 years of age, or in fact earlier than that, ever to take a vehicle. I thought that one ought to walk everywhere. I longed to know what the world was like, and I thought you can't possibly know unless you actually walk.
But that's quite true.
And I really, you can't, can you?
You've got to walk. You see things, you smell things when you walk. But when you are in a car or in a bus, well, you can't see the colour of the flowers or anything.
No, it's much too fast, or you're too low, or too high. But I walked across Spain from the south to the north when I was a very young man. I walked a great deal in France. And simply because I just liked the slowness of the pace, observing the landscape and talking to the people.
Yes.
I really wanted to know people, and I think by walking I knew people. What really annoys me in going in cars is that I don't know even my nearest and dearest.
And
if I were sitting in a car
either.
And I can't read, when it's in a travelling monk cell, which is...
I do agree.
It's interesting, though, that you all must have been alive when, though, young... when the car was still exciting and new.
Yes, I remember my first car drive, and you wore a large hat and then you tied a veil round it so that it didn't blow off. This must have been in the very early 1900s. Mm-hmm. It belonged to my aunt. We had a rich aunt. We were not a very rich family, but we had a rich aunt who occasionally provided interesting experiences.
Mm-hmm. After we married and we lived in Oxford, we bought a second-hand Morris Cowley. Yeah. And I had two lessons and then drove the family to Woodstock, running over a non-road train duck on the way. However, I brought them back safely.
You wouldn't have had to have a driving...
No, no driving license. But not a test. Mm.
No test, no driving license.
There.
I don't remember a driving
Long
license.
After tests came in. They were many, many years later. Mm.
And I could then, when I was introduced to a car and got into it, the smell of it was appalling. And in fact, until I was about 35 years of age, I was always ill in cars.
It's like a terrible handicap.
My can't drive one either.
My first car sounds very grand. Was a Rover, but it was not at all grand in those days. I sold my pension policy in order to buy it because the pension policy didn't seem very important at that time. And it was a two-cylinder air-cooled. no water cooling, and it used to go in leaps and bounds like that. I was terrified of it, like a wild animal.
I always imagine that the years between the wars, the years that in fact Robert Grave called the long weekend, as full of picnickers, hikers, bikers. I thought of you all as active rather than passive people. Would you say that's true, Fenner? That you were much more active then than we are perhaps now?
Oh, I should have thought so. I suppose I've been an activist all through my life. Ever since 1906, when I was a sub-liberal agent in the general election. And we won the constituency for the first time. It's
well
never been
done.
Won since,
no,
other
well
than
done.
A Conservative. Mm. Well, I've been an activist all my life, yes.
Mm. Mm. If I could just ask you this about your the years between the war, would you say they were enormously pleasant if you blocked out perhaps what was happening elsewhere in the country?
It was very poor, but I didn't want to be. I didn't want to be otherwise. I was happier doing my work. I put up with where I lived. I had to go and live in the country because I was so poor, but it was cheaper to live in the country. I enjoyed the countryside. And I enjoyed my friends, and especially my older friends, the people of the older generation, who seemed to me extremely interesting. Mm. And I almost revered them. They were so delightful and struck me as being so intelligent. Mm. So. I think I look back upon it as a very happy period for travelling. I mean, for instance, it was very cheap. One could travel very, very cheaply if you didn't ask, as long as you didn't make high demands, which I didn't and couldn't. I spent 6 years out of England after I was 20 years of age and lived on next to nothing. Mm-hmm. I would make no social judgment about this. I know perfectly well that this was rather a bad time in Europe. But nevertheless, from my point of view, it was most instructive, great education, and very easily got.
Mm-hmm. Just looking back over the 11 days of the 1980s, Afghanistan, Iran, Northern Ireland, the steel strike, you wonder where we're going. But were things better in 1900? Here are the views of the eminent politician, Manny Shinwell, 96 this year, who believes there was no such thing as the good old days.
I don't understand why people nowadays regard the conditions at the beginning of this century or at the end of the last century as good, lovely in the garden. They were far from being that. We'd far too many slums, we still got some. And we ought to get rid of them as soon as possible, but we had far more and more squalor, more filth, and of course more poverty and more hunger. Starvation was quite a common thing among the working classes in those days, and I experienced it myself sometime.
So on social grounds, the early years of this century were far from rosy, but with the giant steps that the 20th century has taken in welfare, medicine and science, does Lord Shinwell think that things are any better now?
But I'm bound to say this, looking back over this practically a century, I don't think we've made anything like the progress we should have made. We have nothing, when it comes to the matter of achievements, when we're asked what our achievements are, I look around, I look at the bad behavior, the bad manners, the vandalism, the hooliganism, and all that's happening in other parts of the country, the hijacking, the murders that are taking place, the violence, all that sort of thing, and I wonder, what, we've had all the education. Well, what's the cause of it all? We've had the churches operating, we've had governments operating, and yet we don't seem to be better off culturally and socially and in civilized behavior as one would have expected. And as regards progress, of course, we've got a kind of social security. People don't starve as much as they starved when I was young. They don't have to experience that, unless through their own fault. They can always rely on the state, on the community. But the improvements that have taken place are nothing like what should have happened.
Oh dear, he doesn't sound too happy about the present, but I'll go first to the past with you.
When I was about 22, I went to as a journalist to Spain. And I suddenly encountered the poverty of Europe. The poverty of the peasants, the unrest among the population, the indignation among certain Spanish leaders and people at the time, the confusion of it. And I thought how extraordinarily lucky I've been being brought up in England, where there seems to have been rather a more orderly government. But here is a country on the edge of revolution. In fact, that was rather long delayed. But nevertheless, it was the first time I really met really deep poverty, poverty far greater than was known in industrial England. Mm. And I think that was the really first time. Of course, I had seen poverty before in England, but then I was brought up in the South. I certainly remember being very shocked by walking down Euston Road and seeing, or indeed in North Country towns, and seeing this procession of unemployed people walking, these men walking 10 yards apart, not speaking to each other, nothing to do. They just walked all day long, stopped at every shop window, considered the shop window, and then moved on to the next one. This was horrifying. But I think probably emotionally, This earlier experience in Spain made a very much stronger impression on me, because it made me think also that we were, despite all our complaints, living in a curiously privileged position in England, with some sort of sense of perhaps false self-confidence. But there were other countries outside our borders which were nothing like, had difficulties imposed upon them which to us, to me, almost in any class, would have seemed intolerable.
So you were frightened and threatened by that discovery?
I felt frightened and threatened, and indeed that's why I liked being abroad, because I thought it was about time I understood something about English history, that I would never understand it unless I went to the continent and saw history upside down from the point of view of the people outside ourselves. I was rather poorly educated in history, and really any knowledge of European history or world history I have, I simply learned in Spain during it, simply because I didn't learn it from the this confident feeling which we had in England, but from the unconfident feeling which existed abroad. Mm.
Can I ask you the same question, Barbara? When did it occur to you that you were born into a not a perfect world?
Well, it was a good deal earlier. I can't tell you what age I was. I should think it must have been something between 8 and 10. And my family were reasonably well off. We were a sort of standard middle-class academic family, but we were not really very well off. And we had a rich aunt who was married somebody who died young and had left her quite a bit of money. And she used to provide our summer holidays. And we were taken for a picnic. And when it came to lunchtime for the picnic, she had a horse and carriage. And the driver, or coachman I should say, then took his lunch and went into one place, and we sat and had our lunch in another place. And I was terribly upset as to why he should not have his lunch with us. Now, I have no doubt that he probably preferred it as we were supposed to prefer it.
Yes, that,
only in my estimation made it worse, because it meant that he knew where he belonged. And a little later, I was invited to tea, to go to tea with the coachman and his wife in a mews flat. And in a mews flat in those days, you had the flat above, and nowadays you have the garage below, and you get the horrible fumes from the cars, I grant you. But on this occasion, you see that you had the horses below, and the terrible stench came up. And I thought, people live like this.
Yes,
and my aunt
yes.
lives in her substantial Victorian house. And I was terribly upset. And from that moment, my political convictions, I think, were fixed.
While I was still at school, I think the Boer War, and though at the beginning of that war I had supported the British cause, before the end of it I became a follower of Lloyd George, of Keir Hardie, and those who opposed the war. And I was a young liberal. I joined the Young Liberals when I was 14 or 15. I didn't become a socialist until I came as a young journalist to London, lived in a settlement in Islington. And it was the appalling poverty of the people.
When you say appalling, can you give me an example?
Yes, dear. I mean, for example, most of the workers, casual workers, were out of work for half the week. No unemployment benefit. Only the workhouse. And there was literal starvation in their families. children used to be coming to school hungry every day. So many of the women were doing work, one-room family, vermin walls, making cardboard boxes, making artificial flowers. Strange enough, putting the pricks into toothbrushes. Mm. I began to wonder whether cleaning one's teeth was so hygienic as it was supposed to be. To where there'd been three women who'd been making cardboard boxes, living in one room. One of them died. And the two other women had to go on working just to stay from hunger with the dead woman in the same room. And it was those shocking conditions that made me a socialist in 1907. Mm. And if you talk about the good old days, the contrast between then and now, there has been a social revolution, not a socialist revolution, but a social revolution since those days, even in the 1930s.
But isn't many it still underestimated
going on? That. Many, underestimated that. Many Shinwell, I think, was not sufficiently aware of that. He ran it down, the social revolution, but there has been one.
Mm. Well, I think there's been a
tremendous
social
revolution, not a, enough.
A social revolution, not a socialist revolution.
Mm. Mm. Yes.
But there isn't the hunger today. In the 1930s, I did a survey of this country. I could only call my report Hungry England. Mm. There was literally hunger. Well, there's poverty today, unemployment today, but we don't have hunger marches today of the unemployed because they were not hungry as they were.
Well, I was wondering whether we were not still in that revolution. Because our problems, our values, all kinds of things around us are changing so rapidly. It is the symptom of a revolution. We are living now in a revolution. Only perhaps it happens so quickly that we haven't time to sort of absorb it sufficiently.
But do you feel like Fenner, that the good old days were not good old days?
Well, they were good in the sense that one had time and leisure to enjoy a certain kind of life.
If you had a job and if you had money, yes.
Yes, and also one didn't always worry about changes. Now today, aren't we always worried about the changes which are happening? We had the Boer War, there was a Russo-Japanese War, you remember that perhaps? I remember a terrible poster showing, I think, a Japanese soldier jumping over on top of a Russian nurse and killing her like that, as I was a very small child. Well, but we haven't had this kind of global world war that we have today. We have war everywhere now. Mm.
Fenner, do you think we've gained or lost by being no longer the center of an empire?
Oh, we've gained. I mean, the Commonwealth is a great advance from the old empire. We had power then, but it was a power which rested upon the occupation of other peoples, denying them self-government. Countries of Africa, of Asia, have now gained their right of independence. I want to acknowledge at once, though I took a great part in seeking that independence, that I was disappointed by the results. Very often, their countries became governed by black Europeans and black Americans, an elite, or by military who'd been to Sandhurst. That is changing now. Military occupations of African countries is changing. And I regard it as progressive, even though it was disappointing at first. And I'm confident. Countries like Tanzania are going to be a great example to the world. Mm.
Would you run us down like Manny Shinwell did? Us, I mean by that, the sort of younger present moment, Barbara.
No, I would not. I would agree that there is a long way to go, but I think Manny was quite unnecessarily gloomy about the present situation, mm. about what we have in fact achieved in his lifetime and mine. I mean, when I was born, there was no possible relief for anybody in poverty except the poor law. Mm-hmm. There was no social security, there were no child benefits, there was no payment for the unemployed, and so on and so forth, no national health service. And therefore, I think a great deal has been achieved, but I think there's a lot to be done yet.
Mm. There is a lot. Are you saying, nevertheless, that there's a loss of authority in the home?
I think there's a loss of the wrong kind of authority, perhaps, but I'm much more impressed by the easy relationship between young children now and their parents. Certainly over a large part of the community, I'm not sure that it's the whole. Mm. I would never have dared to discuss with my mother. I don't remember my father very well. I would never have dared to discuss with my mother the sort of questions that children take quite naturally now to the parents, I find very often. And I find this free and easy thing very pleasing and satisfactory. I think it has developed less fast, perhaps, in the what we generally call the working classes than it has in the middle classes. Because when I married for the second time and my husband was of strictly working class origin, this was the thing that struck him most when he came into a rather different social circle, the easy relations between the children and the parents, which he had not known in his own home.
And there was much more watching over the children. I mean, taking them to the dentist, to the doctor, and so on. Now parents leave it to the state or the school to take these kind of actions and decisions about the children. Don't you think that's rather a pity?
But this is only true, really, of middle-class people. I mean, what has happened, what the state has done, has made the doctor and the dentist available to everybody.
Yes,
and
but don't the parents a little bit rely too much?
No, I don't think so. I mean, some parents do. I hate generalisations about parents.
Right. Well,
the old society which we grew up in was really based on the family and on groups.
Yes.
The family relationships, I would say, are very much better than they used to be. Much, much better. My relationships with my children my grandchildren or theirs with me are much better than mine with my own parents or my own grandparents. They were all authoritarians. They founded an empire. I did not found an empire, and therefore I am rather looser living. I mean, that's how it is.
Yes.
And I'm thinking much more in personal terms. I think that has been a great improvement. On the other hand, kind of group life which grew out of family life and out of village life and town life, or the people who were like yourself, whatever class you belong to, that has diminished undoubtedly, and we are now sort of fed, as you say, by this delightful instrument, so that we are not really, we don't really depend upon each other for our information or on our discussions, but we depend upon what we're told. We've become transient.
Is it too passive?
Well, yes, in a way it is. Or at least we've been set free in a rather dangerous way. We say, well, it's nothing to do with us, they're looking after it. Mm. We are transients. We invent our behaviour as we go along. We invent our work. We invent the whole time and are not responsible or don't feel anything like as responsible to each other. I think it's most noticeable. Some of the old chaps in my neighbourhood where I live, much younger than me, I may say, say it's extraordinary the decline of character. And I say, well, what do you mean by character? And he said, well, they say, well, you know, first of all, people's lives, they form their own lives in relation to their circumstances. But now their circumstances don't really exist. Their circumstances are looked after, and therefore they need have no character. They therefore can as flow along like sort of anonymous drops of water going down a funnel.
In a steel stream.
Have you got a wish for the next 10 years?
Yes.
Rather quick answer.
A wish for the next 10 years. President Eisenhower once said that a time would come when the peoples of the earth would so revolt against the dangers of nuclear war and of armaments, so revolt en masse that governments would be compelled to respond. Mm. I hope that'll happen in the next 10 years.
I want to thank you all very much indeed.
Thank you.